So, yeah, absolutely. So when you praise the Lord, we want you to do it in your own words. So go ahead and have a seat right now, and you pray. This is your time to pray. When you're praising the Lord, what are you praising Him for? Tell Him right now. Just take a moment and say, God, I just want to praise You for, and you just pray. You just praise Him in your own words, quietly, where you sit. I praise You that You are sovereign and You are good. You're big enough and wise enough and in Your mind have it all figured out beyond us, that You're able to take all things and work them together for the good of those who love You and are called according to Your purposes. I praise You for Your purposes. Praise You that from everlasting to everlasting, You are God. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. I praise You that You are our refuge and our strength and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, ever fear, though the earth change and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Let the nations rage and let them roar. You're the King. You're beautiful. May you be captivated by Your beauty. What amazing. What You who did not spare Your own Son, but delivered Him up for us, how will You not also graciously give us all things? God, You're amazing. Your giving heart, Your gracious heart. We praise You. There's no God like You. There is no God like You. Amen.
The conquering King, Your name we raise. find the water, we never will run dry.
Okay, so what I'd like you to do is, if you would, is back up in your minds and go with me, if you would, back in your hearts and minds to Saturday, okay? Put yourself there. Now, not yesterday Saturday, for you football fans, especially not last night Saturday, you know, the game you stay up. But I want you to put your, let's go back to Saturday after the first Good Friday. Okay? So it's the day, it's Saturday, it's the day after the crucifixion. Now, they didn't call it Good Friday back then. They weren't sitting around on Saturday, on that Saturday, saying, hey, yesterday, man, let's call it Good Friday. That is not what they were thinking. That's not what they were saying. For the disciples on Saturday, following Jesus, had come to an abrupt and unexpected halt. I mean, put yourself in their shoes, right? The death and crucifixion of their beloved leader was crushing. It was disillusioning. It left them fearful. I mean, what's going to happen? What about us? This whole thing is scattered. He's dead. I mean, his body was lifeless. It was cold. It was sealed in a tomb. The Romans were guarding it. The government was corrupt. The government was evil. The religious institutions were just as bad. These leaders, these people that the community look up to, they were all in on it together. They had won. They had killed him. It's Saturday. For the 11 disciples, their future was totally up in the air. You say, wait a minute, 11 disciples, I thought there was 12. Judas hung himself. When? When did that happen? Yesterday. So the biggest question on the disciples' minds and anybody that would think about following Christ on Saturday was, now what? That's the question. Now what? Right? For the past 3 years, come on, you try to put yourself in there. For the past 3 years, they have been all in with Jesus. It was like, this is it. We have found him. Sell everything. Leave everything. Follow him. This is it. This is the Messiah. This is Jesus. For 3 years, they were all in. The movement was building. People were getting healed. The disciples had all kinds of dreams, right? Right up to the very, very end. I mean, it was only a couple days earlier. The disciples are in this big debate, and they're fighting over, hey, let's ask Jesus, let's try and figure out who's going to have the most prominent places in the kingdom. These guys, it's all up and to the right. The future looked great. And all of a sudden, it came radically crashing to a halt. The biggest question in their lives right now was, now what? So have you ever been in a spot like that in your life? You call it kind of a now what spot or point in your life? Maybe you graduate from high school. Now what? You know, you have a graduation party, right? Everybody comes over. That's great. Now what? Maybe you're a college grad. You're going to look at graduation in college. Guess what? The big looming question is, okay, you graduated from college. Congratulations. You walked across. Now what? Maybe you're a mom. You know, that's all you ever wanted to be. Grow up and say, man, I love kids. Man, we have these kids. I pour my life into these kids. And now all of a sudden you realize, you know what? They're leaving home. They're getting married. Now what? Maybe you've been humming along in life, kind of putting things together, stringing together a decent record. All of a sudden, you just really messed something up, man. It's just ugly. You're at work. You finally got the job you wanted. Things are moving, and you totally messed something up. And now you go, oh my goodness, now what? I remember as a kid, our family would vacation in northern Michigan, and we would head to Lake Superior. We'd take times, we'd go to Lake Superior. It's beautiful. The water is clear and cold, and they have miles of beaches, and no one's on them. And so we would head up there on occasion and get the old campfire thing. It was great. We'd cook out hot dogs. Just a tremendous, it's just one of these idyllic kind of situations, right? So it's one of those days we're all there. Their mom and dad are getting all the food out and the hot dogs, and we're out swimming and having a good time. And my mom hollers out, Danny, don't you call me that, okay? She calls me that. She called me that. Danny, where's the matches? I was in charge of the matches, okay? Where are the matches? You know, we're going to have this big party. Well, I'm standing in water up to my armpits, and I reached into the pocket of my cut-off shorts, and I said, well, here they are right here. And they're all standing there going, great, now what? All right? Now, Peter
did something, you know, like radically worse than, oh, here are the matches, Jesus. No, he's just denied Christ three times. The disciples all scattered when he was arrested at Garden of Gethsemane. And these guys are spinning and they're going, okay, I just have dealt with the biggest failure of my life. It was only hours before I'm telling Jesus, no, I'll go to the death with you. And Peter's thinking, I'm the biggest fool. I'm the biggest wimp there ever was. Now what am I going to do? And you know what Peter did? He said, well, the only thing I know how to do, I'm going to go back to fishing. And that's what Peter did. Maybe you're a brand new Christian. Maybe this whole thing's hit you. Maybe you realize, wow, Jesus Christ, and you embrace him as your Savior. And then you say, okay, like, now what? Now what? Now what's my life about? What do we do? How's this radically change me? You know, a now what point in your life? That's where these disciples were. And it was huge. And I want, hopefully you can feel where they were. It was Saturday. Now what? My son and daughter-in-law were just telling me about some new friends that they have in New York City. And the guy was all in, had left his job, everything, and full bore into the Bernie Sanders campaign. Now what? Now what? Okay, you get a little bit of what the disciples are feeling? It pretty much sums up the state of affairs on Saturday. Now what? And then Sunday comes. Okay? You go, well, yeah, it's Sunday, man. Everything's, yeah, but you got to remember, you know, Sunday comes and the disciples start to get some reports. The ladies come back and say, listen, he's alive. Not in the tomb. We saw him. Okay, this is Sunday. By the end of Sunday, most of the disciples had actually seen the resurrected Jesus and are beginning to try and process this. And what was happening was Jesus is saying, he was calling a meeting. Now what? Well, Jesus is calling a meeting in Galilee. That's what's next. You say, what? He's alive? You got to be kidding. Not what? Hey, there's a meeting in Galilee on the Mount. Now, the thing you have to understand is this meeting was on the books before the crucifixion. But so many things that happened and swirling around, the disciples just, you know, forgot about it. I mean, you say, what? Okay, the Last Supper, you know, the whole painting and the picture and everything? Well, at the end of that, this is on Thursday night before the crucifixion on Friday. It says, when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. So they leave and they're going across the Kidron Valley up the Mount of Olives. And right there is the Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus is going to be arrested. But the disciples don't know that. And so they're going down. They just had this Last Supper and it's all wonderful. They sing a hymn and then they're leaving. And here's what Jesus says. He said, you will all fall away from me. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. That indeed is going to happen in just a few moments in the Garden of Gethsemane. And then Jesus says this, but after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee. What's up with that? Oh yeah, you guys are all going to scatter here shortly, but I'm going to get killed, I'm going to rise from the dead, and I want to meet y'all up in Galilee. Galilee was way up into the north. They're in Jerusalem at the time. But you know, you're missing those details, right? I would have. So here's resurrection morning. Here's Sunday morning. Sometimes you read the event, and you go, what in the world is that about? Well, here's resurrection. The first people to discover that Jesus was raised and the first people to see the resurrected Jesus were some women. Okay? They come to the tomb. Listen to what the angel said. The angel said to the women, don't be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who is crucified. He is not here. He is risen. You know, that's the Easter Sunday morning thing. Oh, yeah, he's risen. Just like he said, come and see the place where they lay him. Now listen to the angels. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he's going before you to Galilee. There you'll see him. So the women take off. They're going to take off and tell them. And as they take off, they run into Jesus. They run into Jesus, right? Behold, Jesus met them. Greetings, he says. And they came and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. And then Jesus said to them, listen to what he says. Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. So what in the world is the deal with the meeting in Galilee? There was a specific mountain he had told them to go to and meet him. What is the deal with the meeting? Well, I'd like to take you to that meeting on the mountain in Galilee. In fact, we're going to spend the next 5 weeks at that meeting because it is so monumental, it is so critical. I cannot overstate the importance of what happened in this meeting that Jesus says, now look, all this is coming down. Y'all meet me up in Galilee and we'll sort out. Because what happened there and what he said there would clearly and profoundly answer all of the now what questions that the disciples had. And they will answer the now what questions that any disciple has had ever since the very first ones with Jesus. So, let's go to the meeting. You ready to go to Galilee? To the mountain. Matthew chapter 28. And let's find out what Jesus has to say there. Matthew chapter 28. I'd like you to turn there, and I'll start reading in verse 16. Matthew 28. Take your Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, there's one in the rack. It's really good to follow along with this. I don't have a page number. Sorry, I usually have a page number. The Bible's split up into two sections. There's the Older Testament and then the New Testament. And then Matthew, Mark, Luke, John are the first four books in the Newer Testament. And we're in chapter 28 at the end of Matthew. Okay, you got it? You ready? Here's what it says. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. But some doubted. You go, well, what do you mean? Listen, you have to understand, people a lot of times will say, well, there really wasn't a resurrection of Jesus. These were just women who weren't handling their grief right, and they saw, oh, I saw Jesus. Yeah, you get over it. You know, that's what they say. Or, oh, the disciples, of course, they wanted to see him because their lives were wrecked. And so, understand, he appeared after the resurrection to multiple people. In fact, 1 Corinthians 15:6 says this, Jesus even appeared to as many as 500 people at one time. And most scholars believe that it's this meeting that at least 500 people were there. You know, word gets out. Hey, Jesus is meeting us at the mountain in Galilee. Let's all check it out. So as many as 500 people were there, and Jesus shows up, the resurrected Jesus. So it's pretty hard to say, well, the disciples are just disillusional. 500 people were there, okay? And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything, teaching them to obey all that I've commanded you. And behold, you're not going to do this alone. I am with you always to the end of the age. This is the meeting in Galilee. We're going to spend 5 weeks here. Now, to fully appreciate what was going on in this moment, I want to back up and start with a question this morning. Who in the world did Jesus think he was? Who does Jesus think he is? Now, many of you here this morning, we read this passage, you go, yeah, I've heard that 100 times. Maybe you read the passage and say, yeah, I've heard it 1,000 times. Okay, but listen. You sit there and you go, what? You got to back up and start with a question. Who in the world does Jesus think he is? You say, what do you mean? The first thing he says is this. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Okay, seriously. Who says that? Who says that? Who claims things like that? If you went around, you could go around the world and take an interview and survey people. Do you believe there was a Jesus? Do you believe there's a historical figure that walked around the Middle East whose name was Jesus, kind of altered the calendar and had an image? Yes, people around the world, no matter what religion you talk to, what religious faith system, whatever you talk to, they're going to say, well, yeah, I believe there was a Jesus. They would typically describe, they'll quote him, they'll believe in him, they'll respect him. And they'll typically describe him as a great prophet or a teacher, and certainly someone who had a historical impact and religious leader in the crunch. But listen. Jesus didn't leave it at that. His claims, his authoritative claims, I mean, seriously, if any of us started walking around saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Try that with your kids. Hey, watch that. All authority has been given me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go clean up your room. It's like, they lock us up in the loony bin, right? Because who do you think, when people go around saying, I'm God, really? That's really not a good sign. I want to talk about authority figures and authoritative voices. There are a lot of authority figures in our lives. All of us have authority figures in our lives, and they make decisions. The authority figures in our lives, they make certain decisions. They have certain and they set direction. And the reason? Because they're in positions of authority, right? I mean, you go to work, and somebody walks into your office, says, "I want you to do this, this, and this, and this today." And you go, "Well, who are you?" And they say, "I'm the boss. I own the company." Oh, okay. Drive down the street. Some guy comes knocking, pulls you over, knocks on your door, and gives you a ticket. You got to pay this. You go, "What for, man? Who are you?" "Well, I'm a policeman." All right. So there's authority figures. You go to school and you say, "Well, you got to do this homework." "Why? Who are you?" "I'm the teacher," right? So there's a lot of authority figures in our lives. Jesus didn't say, "I'm the policeman, I'm the judge." He said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Wow. You might think if somebody says that, what do they think they are, God? Now you're starting to hear what Jesus is saying. On numerous occasions in his life, he claimed to be God. Now, we don't have the time to get into all of that, but the people who heard him say these things knew exactly what he was saying. He understood him as saying that he was God, and that's why so many times they said, "This guy needs to be killed. He needs to be stoned. He's blasphemous. Who do you think you are claiming to be God?" That kind of exchange happened on numerous times in Jesus' life. On top of that, he did things and demonstrated his power and authority, and he did it in only ways that God could do. So he didn't just go around saying, "I'm God." He, like, proved it. For example, he had authority and he had a power to heal people over the physical realm, people's bodies and minds. He had the authority and a power over that. Interesting exchange happened one day between a Roman soldier. He was a centurion, which means there was a lot of guys underneath him, but he also had guys above him. And listen to this verbal exchange with him and Jesus. He comes to Jesus because one of his valued servants was paralyzed, must have been an accident or something, and was suffering. And so he says to Jesus, "Jesus, will you heal my servant?" And Jesus said, "Sure, where's the servant? I'll go with you." The centurion says, no, listen. And here's what he said, listen. "I am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I tell soldiers go, they go. I tell soldiers come, they come." So listen, Jesus, here's what he says. "You just say the word and my servant will be healed." And Jesus looked at this Roman centurion, and it says he was amazed at the guy's faith. And he says, "This guy gets it." See, what the centurion recognized is that Jesus had the power and authority over people's physical condition, and all Jesus had to do was say the word. And so Jesus did, and the guy goes home, and the servant was healed. Who does that? Who says that? Matthew chapter 9, some friends brought a guy, lowered him through the roof because he couldn't walk, comes down in front of Jesus. And Jesus says, hey, your sins are forgiven. And people are going, who does he think he is? Going around, hey, your sins are forgiven. What's the guy think? He's God? And Jesus says this, look, so that you know that I have the authority to forgive sins, hey, take up your bed and walk. Matthew chapter 10, he demonstrates in a lot of places in the scripture, he demonstrates he has authority over Satan and the demons and the whole spiritual realm. The demons knew who Jesus was. They knew who he was. Whenever Jesus would encounter the demons, they were always like, what's he going to do to us? What's he going to do to us? I know who he is, and he knows who we are, and they recognized Jesus' authority and power over them. Jesus had power and authority over over nature and natural laws. The disciples are in a boat one night. Storm comes. Jesus is wiped out, tired. He's sleeping in the back of the boat. The disciples think they're going to drown. They wake Jesus up. He wakes up and he goes, be still. And the sea calms. The wind stops. And what did the disciples do? Their reaction. They said, who is this that even the winds and the waves obey him? Jesus had authority over death. He raises Lazarus from the dead and says, I'm the resurrection and the life. You believe in me, you'll live even though you die. And you go, who makes claims like that and then does it over and over and over? And whatever realm you want to look at, Jesus demonstrates that he has all authority in heaven and on earth. At the Last Supper, it says that he got up, he got Jesus knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going back to God. He rose from the table and washed the disciples' feet. Who does he think he is? All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. So Bill Clem is a baseball umpire. He was one of they call him the father of baseball umpires because he really added a lot of color to the position. He was the first guy to start using arm signals, and he was passionate about it. He loved it. He loved baseball. He said, to me, baseball is not a game. It's a religion. He was an umpire for 37 years. He umped in 18 World Series. He really was the father of baseball umpires. The story's told that one day a batter's up at the plate, pitch comes in, shoom, and the batter didn't swing, and so and Bill didn't say anything, and so the batter turns around and kind of snorts at the guy. Okay, what was it? Was it a ball or a strike? And Bill Clem said, "Listen, son, it ain't nothing until I call it." The authority. Jesus says, nothing is anything until I call it. Philippians has this amazing passage where it describes Jesus' humility, death, resurrection, and then we read these words, therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Who do you think you are? And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. He's not only an authority figure, but he had authoritative voices. I want to talk about authoritative voices. Now, we usually revolt, we usually resist authority figures. All right, here's an authority figure, and we go, arr. But you know, it's interesting when you think about authoritative voices, we are all attracted to authoritative voices because We need them because we desire them. We're desperate for them because there's a whole lot that we don't know. There's a whole lot that we don't understand. So when someone comes along as an authority on a certain topic or subject, we're drawn to that. We like authoritative voices. So, you know, all of a sudden you wake up one day and go, oh my word, I have this kid. I don't know what I'm doing. And so you look for an authoritative voice on child rearing. Okay? Maybe you're doing a business and you don't know what it's like, oh my goodness, this is disaster. What do? You look for an authoritative voice in business. You get sick. You come up with cancer. You got some disease or something. What are you looking for? You're not looking for the doctor in the commercial who acts authoritative and say, are you a doctor? No, I stayed in a Holiday Inn Express last night. You don't want that guy, right? You want a true authority. This person's an authority on this particular cancer, right? C.S. Lewis says this in Mere Christianity. I like this. Do not be scared by the word authority. Believing things on authority only means believing them because you have been told them by someone you think is trustworthy. And then listen to this. 99% of the things that you believe are believed on authority, right? This is a first rodeo for all of us through this life. And so you got to believe. So don't be afraid of authoritative voices. He says, in fact, 99% of what you believe is based on someone else telling you this, and you trust them, you believe them. We need authoritative voices. And then Lewis goes on to say that he says, for example, he lived in England. Lewis says, I believe that there's a New York City. And he said, but I've never been to New York City, but I believe there is a New York City because people that I know and trust have been there and told me about it. See? Authoritative voices. Last weekend, I was in New York City, and I'd visited the city a couple times before, but always flown in, and so I told Holly, I says, let's drive, you know, that'd be fun. You know, her eyes get real big. I said, why not? Let's drive. You know, my son and daughter-in-law live there. Let's head down there. So we're going through Manhattan, and you know, it's crazy, but I thought, hey, this is fun, you know, a little entertainment outside of Ashland. So, but you know what? You know how I got through Manhattan driving? I had my phone, and the map app was on there, and that thing was on, and it was an authoritative voice that I needed. So when that lady says, turn left in 500 feet, I turn left in 500 feet. And then when she says, turn right, I turn right. I never listened so closely to a woman's voice in my life as I did that day driving through Manhattan, right? We need authoritative voices desperately to navigate our lives. Listen, listen, listen. Listen to this authoritative voice. John 14:6. Jesus says, I'm the way. I am the truth. Who do you believe? What do you believe? I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. No one gets to God the Father except through me. Listen, that kind of power. Well, who do you think you are? Who in the world do you think you are? All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. That's who he says. Listen, that kind of power and that kind of authority is not something you and I would be wise to ignore. It's just foolish to ignore that kind of authoritative voice. Now, the other thing that's amazing is that kind of authority, all authority in heaven and earth could crush us. You know that. That kind of authority and that kind of power in an instant can annihilate us. That kind of authority and that kind of power can do anything they want in our lives, and you have nothing to say about it. You realize that. But Jesus came to save us. Jesus came to say, y'all are in big trouble, but I'm here because I love you. Jesus came to say there is going to be a judgment coming when the king will crush anything that opposes him. But in the meantime, I came to rescue you. I came to show you the only way to get out of here alive. And we would be wise not to ignore that voice. But here's the trouble we have, right? Isn't it true? Here's the trouble we have. We have become cynical of leaders, whether they're pastors or they're politicians or whatever. We can become cynical of leaders in our lifetime who are making authoritative claims about what they're going to do and not do and whatever else, right? We go, yeah. We've heard that before. You just want us to follow you. We just want us to get on board with your vision, your direct. You just want us to vote for you, right? When Jesus comes along and says some things, you got to see it totally different. Like this, Matthew 16. I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Hey, listen, that's something you can wrap your life around. That's something that may give you some meaning and direction. That's something that may answer the now what questions, no matter where you are in your life and what the situation is. That might be something you'd say, you know what? There's something I could trust. There's something I could throw my life in. That's a movement that I could join. Jesus is not only the ultimate authority figure, he's the ultimate authoritative voice. You know, before you ever hear anything Jesus says or write him off, you got to first understand who he was. This is what Lewis brings out again. It's so good. C.S. Lewis says this. See, Lewis was an atheist, and he actually looked at the claims of Christ, and he looked at his life, and he looked at all these things, and he came to some amazing conclusions. He ended up giving his life to Christ. But in this process, here, listen to what he says. He says, yeah, I know people say, well, Jesus was a great moral teacher, but he wasn't God. Lewis said this. That's the one thing you must not say. A man who is merely a man and said the sort of things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else he was a madman or something even worse. Now, you can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him, kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and you can call him Lord and God. But let's not come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us, and he did not intend to. When Jesus says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth, every single person has to reckon with that. Who does he think he is? Which will raise a very interesting question that Lewis points out, and that's this. Secondly, is Jesus the ultimate authority of your life? How have you responded to him? You either write him off or you call him Lord. Who's the authority figure in your life? Who is the ultimate authority figure? Who is the authoritative voice in your life? I have to ask you. When you face all of the now what moments in life, now what do I do? Now how do we handle this situation? Now where do I go from here? Now how do I handle failure? Now how do I handle kids? Now how do I handle my daily activities? Now who gives direction to your plans? Who gives directions to your work? Who gives directions to your finances? Who gives directions to your future? Who gives directions to your relationship? Who gives direction to your dating life? Who gives direction to all of that? Who is the ultimate authority in your life? Is it still you? See, all of us are born and come out of the chutes, and we're on the throne. We're the king of our own lives. We're the master of our own destinies. We're born this way. We're born saying, God, well, that's nice. Maybe I'll think about it. But I'm running this. I'm making decisions for my life. No one has the right to tell me what to do. For me to give that up, I'll lose all my freedom. But a real Christian, okay, a real Christ follower, a real disciple, a learner of Jesus, is someone who has found true freedom, who has found true life, who has found true forgiveness, has found true meaning and purpose in life by surrendering to the King. Surrendered to the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the ultimate authority. All right, so here's what I want to say as I close. The series is called Real Church, okay? Real Church. And if we're going to get into this series, it's got to start with a basic fundamental understanding of this. First of all, real church is people. When Jesus said, I will build my church, he was talking about people. He was talking about calling people out of darkness into light. He's talking about people who are spiritually dead. He calls them, makes them alive, and puts them together in these congregations. All right? He connects them. He puts them in this group. This is my church. It's a group of people. It's described in his body, and he is the head. So the church is people. Church is made up. Real church is people who have said, Jesus is going to be my authoritative voice. I believe he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one gets to the Father except through him. And so Jesus has become my Savior. I've surrendered my life to him. He is my Lord. I'm a disciple of his. I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm all in with Jesus. That's who the real people in the real church are, okay? So, then the rest of the phrase, real church is people whose entire lives are defined and directed by the resurrected Jesus Christ. So you got to get this. We're going to do a whole series called Real Church, okay? So we're going to dive into the scriptures. We're going to look at the book of Acts. We're going to look at this Matthew. What is real church? Well, it's people whose entire lives are defined by the resurrected Jesus Christ. There are people who go, he was the Son of God. He was God, and he came to die for my sins and was a substitute for my sins. So 2 Corinthians 5, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. All things are new. All the other stuff's passed away. All the old has passed away. Everything has become new. So your whole identity is rooted in Jesus, the resurrected Jesus Christ. Real church are people whose entire lives are defined by, I'm in Christ. It's my identity. And are directed by the resurrected Jesus Christ. So when Jesus says, I will build my church, and all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth, go therefore and make disciples. They go, I'm in. Jesus says, jump. I say, how high? Jesus says, you follow me here. I follow him there. Jesus says, you go here. I go there. Jesus says, this is what your life looks like, how you obey, what's right and what's wrong, and what the direction of your life is and the meaning and purpose of your life. You go, that's right, because that's who you are. Real church is people whose entire lives have been defined by and directed by the resurrected Jesus Christ. Two verses and we're done. This comes out in the book of Colossians. Paul writes later on, and watch how this fleshes out in Colossians. He, God, has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us, this is salvation, to the kingdom of his beloved Son. Now I was in the kingdom of darkness, Satan. Now I'm in the kingdom of Jesus Christ, his beloved Son. I got transferred there by an act of his grace at the moment of salvation. This is who we are. It's all defined by the resurrected Jesus Christ, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of our sins. For by him, who is this Jesus? Who in the world does he think he is? By him, all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible, visible, whether thrones or dominions, or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. So real church, folks, you want to talk about church? It's made up of people whose entire lives are defined by and directed by the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, who said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Who is the ultimate authority of your life? Let's pray. Father, this brings us to this massive crossroad, every single one of us here this morning. Every week, Lord, the people indicate that if you're here this morning and you wouldn't be alone, we're going, wow, this is really coming clear to me today. And Jesus Christ is not the ultimate authority of your life. You thought he had some nice ideas. Maybe you prayed to him, talked to him, learning about him, but you'd never come to that place where you surrendered and said, okay, he is my Lord, my Savior, my God. And you can do that right now where you sit. Say, God, forgive me. I'm a rebel in your universe, and I come this morning to repent of sin and to embrace Jesus Christ, and he will be my Savior, and he is now my Lord. I surrender to him as my King and the ultimate authority of my life. I want to be defined by him and directed by him. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ and have made that decision at some point in your life, maybe God's using this to refresh of where you stand. We can stray and forget so easily. God, mark us today by the meeting in Galilee. In Jesus' name, amen.